London soon became like a second home to Marlon, living in rented flats in Camden and Bayswater. Yes, my friend. He found himself mixing with some of the rising stars of Britain's own reggae scene, including Brinsley Ford, who later formed Aswad, and Loxley Gishi, lead guitarist in the Cimarrons.
Control me now.
Bad tune.
Bad tune, man. This tune is like a, you know, keep it down.
When Bob come first, right? Bob wasn't even Rasta them time,
was he? No, big afro.
Yeah. and they used to wear it in plaits, so you see the bend and kick up.
Yeah, soul rebel. I'm a rebel. So Bob said to us, I'm looking for a band to do some gigs around London. If we could do it. It's, of course, man, no problem with that, you know? And the first gig we did, it was alongside John Nash. We were together at the Apollo Club, Middlesden. Yeah, you couldn't believe it.
This is the club where you played?
Yeah, Apollo,
yeah. London Apollo.
That's Apollo Club right
here. And it's still there. It's still got the sign, everything.
Yeah. By the summer of 72, Marley had been joined in London by the rest of the Wailers.
Day's done. Yeah, I'll be sorry that you breezed in.
The band set up base in this quiet North London suburb.
Illuminated signs also welcome to the borough that everybody's pleased in. Neasden
was really a quiet, I wouldn't say gentrified, but it was an up-and-coming quiet town. In 1972, I started to work at the Co-op in Neasden Lane. So I remember one afternoon, this person walked towards me in had a berry. And as he came nearer to me, I mean, it's silly now, but I asked him the question. I said, but you're Peter Tosh. And he just nodded and he went on. So I remember speaking to a good friend of mine, Delroy Washington. And he said to me, yeah, the Wailers, they're actually living not far from here, just around the corner. So I went with him that evening after finishing work, and sure enough, at the Circle, there was Bob Marley, Peter Tosh, Bonnie Wailer. It was just like I was in a dream. Here we are in the Circle. Yeah. We're coming to it. This is the house where Bob Marley stayed.
Yeah, this is right here on the left.
Yeah,
man. Look at it. this is the house.
Yeah.
Remember, come back now.
She gonna take a look?
Yeah.
This wasn't like this.
No.
This wasn't like this. And the door was different.
Yeah, it was all different. Yeah. And there's a back garden around there. At the back, remember the back garden? Yeah.
I don't remember the back garden too much.
The garden around there, yeah.
So when Bob them came here, to the people of the area, was like, what is going on?
Yeah, they didn't know what that meant, yeah.
In Bob and Bunny, they would walk as a group. Mm. I mean, it just looked like the picture on Catch a Fire.
Yeah.
You'd see them walking up the main street.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it would be like watching the Beatles now walk up a main street, do you know? It was still different. There was an atmosphere, there was an aura about them.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
For me, being big fans of the Wailers, mm-hmm. it was like, this is not real. It's not real. We were in there one night jamming,
mm-hmm.
and Bob said, give me that guitar there. Mm-hmm. And he sat on the bed and started strumming a tune.
Yes.
And I always remember it as being, we don't need no more trouble.
We don't need no trouble. Bob was really, very, always thinking. He's a man, he's a thinking man. Sometimes he go very quiet, isn't he? Sometimes he go very, very quiet. And sometimes he'll be just, loud.
We never realized we was in the presence of someone who would transcend worldwide.
Yeah. I mean, good memories, you know? Very, very good memories.
But in 1972, Bob Marley was still far from a household name and had to seek unexpected avenues in his attempts to reach a wider audience.